I am very happy to be doing this webinar. This webinar is for students, since we have been doing presentations at several universities for psychology students to introduce PRI, the basic concepts. And I think Lenneke did most of those conferences. Lenneke, good to see you. And I think some of the times that you did these conferences that Anna and Janneke were there. Very nice to see both of you, Anna and Janneke. They are both studying psychology, right? Yes, studying psychology. And they have both done PRI therapy. And they will be sharing some of the information on how that was for them. And actually, to give away the scoop, it was so good for them that they are studying psychology because they want to become PRI therapists. So, of course, this is very good. I'm very happy about that because we see now, I mean, it's been almost 20 years since I've been working on PRI, and the first book I wrote came out in 2000. So we're approaching 20 years of very, very hard work. And a lot has been established, but it's very important to carry the work on to the next generation. So that's why I'm very happy to be sitting here talking to students, which I consider to be the next generation of therapists, so that you know a little bit more about PRI and how effective it can be. So the thing that for students, if I understood well, some of the things that have been addressed is how, you know, when you need, I mean, of course, I was a student once myself. And you know how it is, you have to do your studies and then you're sitting there and then there's a friend that calls, or you know, nowadays you have all your social media and then you have YouTube and then you think, well, I'll just watch one little film and then another video. And so, you know, the postponing of doing what you need to do is something that can really make it very difficult for you to get the results in your studies that you want. Also, of course, insecurity can play a very big role, of course, in all of life, also for older people, but for younger people especially, you know, you don't really know so well, what do I want, who am I, what are my strong points, what are my weaker points. So insecurity and the stress that comes from all of that and having to find your way in life, in short, you know, having, you know, what I remember for myself when I was your age, I sound really like a grandmother. Funny, but I remember that it was great because, you know, it was freedom to be a student, and I did a lot of partying and it was wonderful. But at the same time, I remember very well the great insecurity of not knowing where is my life going, what do I want out of life, what can I do in life, and so fear was a very, very big part of my life also. And not knowing what this was about, I thought, my God, I'm crazy or something. What's wrong with me? Why am I afraid of things that are not dangerous, like speaking in front of a group? That sort of thing really scared me a lot. Even going to the university, I had a certain moment in my life where I really felt afraid to go to the university in Amsterdam where I was studying at the time. And I didn't understand. I thought, What is this about? So thinking back on those days, it was, you know, it would have been wonderful to have understood that those reactions of stress and fear and insecurity and postponing behavior, that those were defenses actually that were hiding something completely different underneath, which was about my early childhood. And most of you, I think, already have some idea what PRI is about. So you know that we all carry old pain within us. We have all experienced things when we were very young children, babies, sometimes even before we were born, that have been stored in our system and we don't know about this. It's unconscious. It's in the emotional brain, and it's in, you know, it's been really repressed, so we don't remember how it was, but our bodies remember. So if there's something in the present that somehow resembles what we lived through when we were very young, the defense survival system that we all carry within us is going to be, you know, awakened. And that's when the five defenses that I write about and that we work with in PRI are activated. So we have the fear defense, so that means becoming afraid of something that's not life-threatening. We have the, what I call the primary defense, which is the defense of becoming, you know, feeling guilty that, you know, you can't do anything right, that you're not good enough in some way or another, that everything is just too much for you. It's like this overwhelmed feeling. That's what I call the primary defense. Then there's the false hope, which is the defense in which we get very stressed and try to do our best. And we can even exhaust ourselves in that. And then there's the false power defense, which is a defense in which you always think it's the fault of other people. So you get angry, irritated, judgmental. And lastly, the fifth defense is the denial of needs, which is the defense in which we deny that there is a problem. It's the defense in which, you know, you say, oh, how are you? Oh, it's, everything is fine. You know, it's just like you're like living a little bit in a cloud of denial that there is any urgent matters or any problem or anything to really be worried about in the present. Now, if you recognize any of these five, that means simply that your mind is taking you hostage to believe in an illusion, because these five defenses are just illusions of the mind. And these illusions have been activated because somehow in the present, you are perceiving, that means seeing or hearing, mostly with those two senses, you're seeing or hearing something which, without you knowing it, is touching upon something that you experienced when you were very small, some early life stress that you couldn't deal with when you were such a small child, and you had to push it away, put it out of your consciousness. So that's what happens. And PRI helps you to understand why you have these defensive reactions. So it's a very practical method. It's in a way, it's very simple because it's very exact if you know how to apply it. And I would love to show you with two demonstrations today, with Anna and one with Janneke, how it works. I have no idea what they have prepared, but they said they had prepared something to do with, you know, their studies and something that was causing them trouble in their studies. And then after these two short demonstrations, there will be some time for any of you to ask questions. And then we will close at 5 o'clock. Okay, so first of all, before I do the demonstration with you, Anna and Janneke, would you be so kind to tell us a little bit, very short, just, you know, in a few minutes, about your adventure with PRI and what did it do for you? What did it change concretely in your life?
Yeah, sure. Well, I started PRI like I think 3 years ago, and I think I'm much more relaxed than I was back then, and I well, the main thing was that I didn't allow myself to have needs and to express them. So, and that's something that I've learned, that expressing my needs and my feelings is something that there wasn't room for in my youth. So that's something that I discovered in therapy, and that's why I can rest now and I allow myself to put on a jacket if I'm cold, and I didn't do that back then. So I think that's one of the most improvements in my life.
You didn't put on a jacket if it was cold?
No, I just was hard to myself. So no, I don't care. Just live with it. And yeah, I couldn't take the bus, and yeah, like just really harsh on myself. And I learned to be kind and allow myself more
to eat. That's very, very important. Yeah. Huh? Yes, self-compassion is so important. So you would be very harsh with yourself, and now you can have the compassion and you can be softer on yourself. And you can say that you can relax? Because before you had more stress in your life. What were you suffering from?
Well, I still that I think that's my main thing still, that I find it hard to relax, to just take care of other people, and mm-hmm. So that's still something that I work on, but I see now that's rationally I see it's not my responsibility to make others feel right, so I know that now. And back then I was always running and keeping balls high just to make everybody happy and don't make don't make somebody mad. And I think that's one of the best things right now, that I can relax more in, don't make somebody else's issue my issue.
Yes, of course, always taking care of other people and feeling guilty if you wouldn't do everything for the people. That's what you mean?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, that's quite a difference, eh? That you know that my problems are mine and someone else's problems are their problem. It's not your responsibility. Of course, we can help other people. That's never a bad idea, I think, in general, but it's not because you're responsible for them.
Yeah, exactly. And it's still something that I fall into some here and then, but I know it now and I can feel it, and I just have to stop myself by not doing what I used to do and just take care of myself first and then to be here for the other person.
Okay, Jan, so that was for you the most important thing, the stressful feeling, being harsh on yourself, that was
being harsh on myself. For me, it led to an eating disorder. So I didn't allow myself to eat. So I recovered. That's the biggest improvement.
Yeah. Is it difficult to recall that with us, Janneke? Is it difficult for you to talk about it?
No, not really. Maybe I'm feeling a little anxious for just putting myself out there, but it's
Well, thank you so much for sharing it, because you know how eating disorders are so prevalent. There are so many people suffering from this. Mm-hmm. And it's an incredible, it's such so much suffering associated to it.
Yes, and, exactly.
Not your fault. It's so important to realize with these kind of problems, and you know that people tend to think, oh, it says something about me, but it's not your fault.
No,
it's not. And it's actually, not
I'm sorry.
Yeah, maybe
not just about wanting to be skinny or have control. Just about that something is touched underneath, and I think that's so important to know, because otherwise you're always blaming yourself, and it's just not
exactly. And actually, my next book, I'm going to be writing a series of little books, and the first one of these little books is going to be about eating disorders.
Good. Thank you.
If everything goes right, it should be in the store next year in the spring of 2019. And it's exactly, you know, one of these things is what you're saying. Not eating what you should eat is not about being a control freak or wanting to get even with your environment. It's about not wanting to feel, because the feelings that are underneath are feeling as if they're too life-threatening. Mm-hmm. And that's really what it's about. And it's very important that this message comes out there.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, Janneke, thank you so much for sharing that with us. I think that a lot of people might, be helped to understand this.
Yeah.
And how about you, Anne? What was your, what was bothering you? Why did you start doing PRI, and where are you now with that?
Yes. Well, can you hear me okay?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, so I started PRI in secondary school because I was studying like all the time, and I pressured myself very hard to get high grades, and yeah, it was okay until I noticed that the only thing I actually did was studying, and I figured that I also wanted to do some other things like hobbies I had that I wanted to like make music or get a job had a job interview at the supermarket, local supermarket, and then I got it, I got the job, and then I denied it because I was afraid that I wouldn't have enough time left for studying. And grades I thought I needed to, actually what I know now is that getting high grades for me feels like when I get a high grade, I will belong and people will accept me for who I am. So I was scared that when I did other things and studying, I wouldn't get the grades that I needed to in order to belong. So I was studying all the time and I didn't want to anymore, but I just couldn't stop. So that's why I started PRI, and it helped me a lot because first, as you the studying very hard is of course false hope, and then at first when I worked on that, it crashed, and I got into the primary defense, which at first seemed to make it worse because I didn't feel motivated anymore for studying, but it felt like, oh my god, I can't do this, it's too much, and how am I ever going to succeed? But I also started working with that feeling, and then in my last year when I had to graduate, I actually felt the least stress of all the years of secondary school, so that was great. And now I'm in my second year of the psychology bachelor, and I still have the tendency to want high grades, but now I also do a lot of stuff next to studying. So I have like 3 jobs and I'm sporting, and I try to see my friends, but there's just so much other things to do. But it's way better because I'm not studying all the time and I'm also doing stuff.
Yes. Well, wonderful, because now you can build a life, eh? Instead of just studying. Yes, of course. Okay, Anna. And so it was such a big process for you that you then said, I want to become a PRI therapist.
Yeah. I think I just gained very much from it. And I think it's very interesting. I learned a lot about myself in the process as well. And to understand the feelings I feel and where they come from. And I think that's so helpful in order to work on the issues you have to cope with. And I just want to help other people understand themselves and their feelings as well, because the problems that I see in my surroundings, it's mostly like people suffer from it, but in general it's not a very difficult problem. So if people would just have the opportunity to work with it just like I have, I think they can gain as much as I did from it. So I just wish I could help other people with it too.
Yes, well, that's wonderful to hear, because like you say, if you don't know what it's about, you don't know where it's coming from, then it's very difficult to do anything about it.
Yes.
And then people say, oh yes, well, I just suffer, for example, from depressions, but my mother also was depressed and it's in the family, or we all work very hard, and they don't understand it's actually defense against something that's underneath. And that's quite a big insight. And then there's the way out also, the way out of the tunnel. Yeah, okay, so let's see if we can do a little demonstration. Of course, we can't demonstrate the whole method, that would be too complicated, but we can see if we can show you a little bit of how PRI works. And you'll see that I will begin by asking questions just about the present, actually, about what is the situation that was upsetting and what the perception was in that situation and what the meaning was that perception had for Anna and then for Janneke. And then I will try to ask these questions in a way until I feel that I'm hitting exactly on the point in the emotional brain, in the unconscious mind, whatever you want to call it, where the emotion is actually the old pain, and the emotion is being touched. So then you will see, if we succeed, you will see the old pain coming up, which actually is covered by the defenses. Okay, so maybe with this explanation that you'll be able to understand a little bit of what I will be trying to do. So Anna, is it okay for you if we start? Yeah? Now I have to see if I can make you put in, yeah, that's better. I put you on the big screen so I can see more of your expression, because otherwise you're one of these really tiny little faces. Okay, well, tell me, what would you like to talk about? What situation is actually bothering you?
Yes, so I am quite busy with studying, and I made a schedule for myself for when I would do the different things I have to do for my studies this week. And for this afternoon, I planned to start on a project. And I was reading the instructions, and it said, okay, open this file and, well, answer a few questions about it. So I went to the file and I opened it, and the file was 40 pages long. And it said, read it carefully. And I was like, oh my God, this is 40 pages and I only have this afternoon, and I already postponed this for 2 hours. So I only have 1 hour left, and how am I ever going to do this? So yeah, I got a bit stressed. And also, yeah, just because there's other things I have to do and I have a deadline tomorrow, so.
Yes. Okay, yeah. So, and now you are sitting here and you should be reading this file.
Yeah, what am I doing here?
Oh my God, I can imagine. So that's even more stress. So, okay, so let's start by seeing which defense actually is activated here. Because on the one hand, you could see that what you're telling us, Anna, everybody can you relate to that, because we would all say, my God, you know, you have to read this carefully, 40 pages in 1 hour. I mean, that is impossible. So why would this be a defense? And the reason that I would say it's a defense is because I recognize from what you're telling me that you are sort of like in a state of panic, stress and panic, like, oh my God, you know, it's like a fear reaction. And of course it's unpleasant, but there is no life danger. So the fear, I think, is the defense which is activated in this situation.
Yes.
Would you agree with me? Yeah, it's fear?
Yeah, I do agree, but I think it might be helpful to explain that it is fear that is activated at first, but only for a short amount of time, because the fear doesn't feel very pleasant, obviously. So I very quickly go towards a higher defense, and I start postponing. So this evening my father is celebrating his birthday, and we had to do some preparing stuff as well. So I was like, okay, 40 pages, okay, like, I can't do this. And then first it's like this panic feeling, and then it's like, okay, but I also have to do this, so I'll do this first. So it's denying the problem, actually.
Exactly, that's how it goes, huh? But I always work with, you know, the first defense that's activated, and in this case it was very clear. Your first reaction was, oh my God, you know, how can I do this? So there we have the fear. Okay, so let's see the what we call the symbol in PRI, of course, is this instruction that you're reading. That's what started it off. And then the sensory perception, so that means what are you perceiving, what is the detail in the symbol, because the symbol is the whole instruction, and which exact detail is it that you are perceiving, which is causing, which is actually leading to this defense, activating this defense. So what exactly is the exact sensory perception on it? You already said it, but just so people can follow what we're doing, just ask you again. So what did you perceive that really panicked you?
Yeah, the amount of pages, I actually said, unfortunately. Yeah. And I think mainly the amount of pages, not even that I only had 1 hour to do it.
No, like when you open the file, and you saw, read carefully, 40 pages, please read carefully.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Not like scan through, no, it's like, please read carefully. Huh? That also, that's, I think, an important detail.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. So now we have the symbol, we have the defense, it's the fear defense is activated by the symbol. What's the symbol? Symbol is the instruction, the whole thing that you needed to do. What's the sensory perception detail in the symbol is that phrase, that one phrase, like, please read carefully, 40 pages. So then the next important question, we're going very quickly, so that's why I'm repeating, otherwise it might be over too soon. So could you please close your eyes so you can concentrate? And bring yourself, let yourself go back to that moment where you open this file and you see this phrase, like, please read carefully 40 pages. What actually is the message, the meaning, coming towards you from this phrase? It's as if it is saying to you, what? And now here, this is important to understand. Now we're speaking to the unconscious. We're speaking to the emotional brain, not to the rational brain. So now that's why I'm asking Anna to close her eyes and to go inside and to go back to the moment that she was sitting there behind her computer and she's opening this file. And what actually is coming towards her when she sees this phrase about the 40 pages? It's as if the message is, and here you have to feel, Anna, what is coming towards you?
Yes, that only if I do this correctly, that I will be accepted, I think.
I'm sorry, what did you say? I couldn't hear you.
So only if I successfully follow the instructions, I will be accepted.
Okay, now this, Anna, is your idea.
Yeah.
Your feeling. This is your false hope actually talking. If I do so and so, then I will be accepted. So we're not looking for the defense that's activated. We're looking for the meaning, and the meaning is what's coming towards you. Imagine that this file, this document was talking to you. Just look at your screen. Imagine this screen becoming really big. Imagine yourself becoming very small. And this phrase where it says 40 pages, please read carefully. What kind of energy is coming towards you? What kind of a message is coming towards you? What kind of a, you know, make it really big. Imagine it's maybe even shouting at you. What is it saying?
That would be, do this correctly or you can leave.
Okay, please keep your eyes closed, Anna, for a moment. Make it big, make it really big. Imagine this computer becoming bigger and bigger and bigger, and imagine yourself becoming smaller and smaller, and imagine that these letters that you're seeing, that the writing is becoming, you know, it's saying something, it's becoming sound, and it's coming towards you. So what is coming towards you? Just make it big in say it's simple words of a child, you know. What do you feel? It's actually, imagine it screaming at you. What is it screaming at you?
do this or go away.
Okay, keep your eyes closed for a moment, please. Do you feel inside there when you said that? Yeah, the go away, yeah? It's the go away. Yeah, okay. Okay, so Anna, this is really where the old pain in you is being touched. It's the threat, it's very threatening. The old pain is about a small child that feels threatened that it had to go. Get out of here, go away. Okay, and so in order not to feel that old pain, your system activates a defense, and in your case, it's the fear defense. Oh my God, how am I going to do this? And you focus on the study, but the truth actually is that this old pain is being touched. And that's the good news, is that it's over. It's gone. It's over. It's in the past. It will never happen again, because you will never be that small, vulnerable child again that you were. Oh, you can open your eyes if you want. How do you feel, Anna?
It touched me. But I know this feeling. It's okay.
I'm sorry? It touched you, but?
Yeah, I'm very familiar with this feeling. I tried to feel it for a bit.
And I'm sure you have worked on this feeling, so it's not completely, you know, it's not mind-blowing to you. It's not like you have to collapse on the floor. I mean, you know this, you know what it's about, right? You know this old reality, what happened to you when you were small.
Yes.
Okay, so that's actually what it's all about. It's about this pain that's being touched. And instead of feeling that, your system activates the defense. And it's first it's the fear, and then it's false hope, and then it's denial of needs. Huh? The false hope, like, oh, I have to do this, and then denial of needs, oh, well, I'll do it some other time, I'm going to postpone it. Okay, so thank you, Anna, for wanting to share this with these people in public. I can imagine that's a very courageous thing to do.
Thank you.
Might be a big step also to, you know, show this. So you did a really great job, and thank you so much. And it shows, huh? You showed very clearly how the present and the past are connected, but in order to not feel that connection, we put this big barrier of defenses in between. And those defenses actually make our lives much more difficult than they need to be.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Is there anything you would like to say, or that you want to ask, or?
I think it's interesting because I know this feeling. But like you heard, of course, is that I first said, as the meaning of the symbol, that it would be do this correctly or go away. But I think my false hope is still in there. And
exactly.
I had not yet noticed that yet. So I think that's very helpful to know now that these situations just give me the feeling that I have to go away. And my false hope is acting on that, but that's not the meaning of it.
Exactly. Good. That's really important. Yeah. Well, I'm very happy that I could give you that little detail that makes a difference. Yeah. Okay, Anna. So I would wish you good luck with whatever you have to read. I don't know when you're going to read. Sometime. Huh? And thank you so much for sharing this with us.
Yeah. Thank you.
So,
and you're okay, thanks.
Okay, so then now we'll go on to Janneke. Hello, Janneke. You also prepared.
Yes,
a situation.
You want to be study related, right?
Well, it could, for me, it doesn't matter really. It could be anything. Just something that you are, that you are, that you would really like to, I mean, take, you know, you're talking here with me, so you just take advantage of the situation, anything you want.
Okay. Well, then there's a situation with my boyfriend, and yeah, he was down the couple of days a little bit, and I felt that I was today I felt down also, and I just stayed in it. I didn't come out, so well, I'm feeling a bit better right now, but I was just down, and I find everything hard, and yeah, just didn't enjoy the day.
Okay. And was there, did that's, when was the last time that you did not feel down?
I think last night.
How were you feeling last night? How were you feeling? What were you doing? What was going on?
I was studying. I was writing my thesis. And I felt, I felt fine.
Yeah, you felt fine. Okay. And then you went to bed and you were fine?
Yeah. I didn't was aware of my emotions because I was really, I think I was taking care of him. So I didn't know how I felt myself, I think. But today I really noticed that I was feeling down. And so.
Okay, because Janneke, you said that he was already a few days ago that he was feeling down.
Yeah, that's true, but I think I think that's my mechanism. So when he's down, I put my own emotions a little bit on the side, and today he was feeling better, and then I went down.
Okay, so actually it started then when he was feeling down a few days ago that you go into what we call denial of needs. That's what it sounds like, right? Is that correct?
Yeah. Yes, that's correct.
The defense in which, you know, you don't really feel much anymore.
Yeah, that's correct.
Because do you remember which day it was that he was feeling down? When did he start to feel down?
I think Monday.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because the weekend was fine? You had a good weekend together?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay, so then Monday he started to feel down, and then there was a reason for that? Something happened to him?
Yeah. I don't know if he liked it, if I shared. So.
Okay, but something happened. So you don't have to share, but something happened, and then he started to feel bad.
Yeah, and it was something I did.
Okay, something you did. Okay, so can you go back to that moment then, Janneke? And just before that moment, you were still feeling okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, so that's actually where it all started. It's not today, it's actually Monday when he started feeling bad because of something that, you know, you did.
Yeah, I know, it's difficult because I felt better like past days because I was in denial. But yeah, you're right, it started Monday.
Yeah, okay, so see, this is something in PRI that's so important, that you go back to the last time that you were still feeling okay. Don't go back to when you started feeling bad, because sometimes, you know, there was something else going on before and your mind blocks it. So it's important to go back to the last one where you're feeling fine and then see what happens. So it's already started on Monday, and the defense that's activated is the denial of needs. Mm-hmm. As you said, when you first introduced yourself, you said it was difficult for you to feel your needs, to feel your feelings, to feel what you need, to have compassion for yourself. So here is the denial of needs defense,
yeah,
which very much associated to eating disorders.
Yes.
It's very much about that, about not feeling your needs, even not feeling the need to eat. So the denial of needs was activated, and the symbol that started all of this was clearly you, was your boyfriend.
Yeah.
That's not so difficult, eh? In this to find. Sometimes it can be difficult to find, but in this case, it's obvious your boyfriend. So now the next question, what is it that you were perceiving, Janneke? So we go to the sensory perception, like I did with Anna. What are you perceiving that actually activated this denial of needs? Try to really see or hear something. Sometimes it can also be what you feel, smell, or taste, but mostly it's the two senses, the seeing or the hearing. So what is it? What do you see or hear?
I see someone, I see that he is face down, just looking at the ground, and his voice is low and just no emotion, and just like
no emotion
in his voice, or just like really steady and just
So it's like a flat voice.
Yeah, flat and soft.
Okay, and he's looking down.
Yeah.
Okay.
Just in.
And is what he's saying important to you, or is it mostly about what you're seeing? What is touching you most? What is putting you most in? It's difficult because it's denial of needs. But what if you go to that situation, you focus on him, Janneke? Is it what you see, or is it maybe what the contents of what he's saying that's touching you most?
It's not the content. It's more the sound of his voice, I think.
Oh, the sound of his voice. Okay, so it's the nonverbal behavior. Okay, and then the. Very good. So now imagine that you become small and he becomes really big. Imagine him becoming like 3, 4, 5 meters and you really small, and he has this flat voice, this monotonous voice without any expression in it. And what is coming towards you from that voice? It's as if he's saying what to you? Try to feel what is the message for you behind the way in which he's speaking.
I think he's not even focused on me, but just, I don't think he just looks away and not giving me any attention.
Yeah, so. What is he saying with that? What is the message that behavior actually is giving?
That there's no room for me, I think.
There is no room for you. What? Imagine a message coming from him with this behavior, with talking like this, with looking away, Janneke. It's as if he is saying to you, you don't mean anything to me. You don't exist for me. I don't care for you. What is coming towards you?
I don't want you here.
No. Yeah. Can you feel it, Janneke? I don't want you here. Okay, so that says something about what happened when you were very small, and it's the old pain that you carry inside, programmed in your body and in your emotional brain. And this behavior of his is a reflection somehow of something that happened to you in the past. Somebody who was important to you in the past, usually it's one of the parents, had similar behavior. And so now when someone does something that has a slight resemblance, the old reality and the old pain is touched. So you can feel it, huh? When you have the exact meaning that you have touched the old pain, the exact old pain, you immediately feel it. It's a physical reaction. You can feel it in the body. And some tears or sadness will come up.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. So how are you feeling, Janneke?
Feeling okay. A little maybe overwhelmed or something.
Yes. Yeah. Would you like to say something about what you mean by overwhelmed?
I think, my body reacts in a heavy way. So it's, my stomach is aching and I'm like, in that moment I feel like, no, stop, just don't say that, just go away. And so I'm feeling a little just stressed at that moment, and I have to
You felt stressed in the moment where I asked you what the meaning was.
And I thought, why?
don't go there. Of course because this is the old reality. The good news is that it's over and you have survived it, Janneke. You could never be that small vulnerable child anymore that somehow lived through the experience of being at certain times in situations in which this was the message coming towards you: I don't want you here, by a parent who was in their own world, maybe depressed or distracted or with their own troubles. And couldn't, make the room and the attention for the child that you were. And of course, it's not about blaming any parents, because parents usually do all they can, but they have their own problems. And then dealing with your problems and having a small child is very, very difficult. Anybody who has had children will know that. Okay, so there you see, Janneke, what happens. This pain, in order not to feel this pain, your psychological immune system or defense system, whatever you want to call it, just comes in between the present day perception and the old pain that's directly linked, and it just breaks the connection. And instead of feeling the old pain and knowing it's old, you go into denial of needs, and in your case it means not feeling anything anymore, cutting yourself off from your feelings, and starting to focus on your boyfriend. Because that's what I think you do. You start helping him or worrying about him or thinking what you can do for him.
Funny, because I didn't realize that, really. I just thought, I'm fine.
Well, that's denial of needs. It's the hardest defense to recognize, because people will say, "No, I'm fine."
But if you, I'm fine. How are you? That's like.
But if you think back, if you think back on those where you were in denial of needs, do you recognize, Janneke, that there's somewhere in the chest area that it's sort of like a grayish feeling, like gray, like there's just nothing. It's not white, it's not black, it's just sort of
there. Yes, and also maybe sometimes a little anxiety is about to break through, and then I'm just already pushing it down, just, no, I'm okay. So just giving any attention to it, but just going back to the state, like, okay, I'm fine.
Yeah. So it's good to be able to recognize, you can recognize in your body usually the difference between really feeling fine, and then your whole body feels alive,
yeah,
and it's full of energy and movement, versus denial of needs, I'm fine, because then actually it's almost like the body is shut down and there's not much happening there.
Yeah, I think that's a good explanation.
Yeah. Okay, well, thank you so much for sharing this with us, showing so clearly how our consciousness is, you know, constructed out of three parts, the present, and then the defenses, and then the old pain. And there's like walls in between. And we can actually cross these walls when we know the right questions. We can go from one compartment to the next and get out of the defense.
Yeah.
Okay. Good. Well, thank you so much. Is there anything you want to ask or add, or do you want to give some feedback on how this was for you?
Yeah, it was good. It was helpful, and well, maybe interesting. Like when this happens, happened a couple of years ago. This was the moment that I would stop eating. So it was like, oh, someone has said I don't want to feel this, so I stopped eating, and then I just didn't feel anything anymore.
Yeah, so. Imagine, yeah. That's how effective, huh?
Yeah,
it is. Stop your feelings. Stop. All that eating disorders are about not feeling, not feeling the pain that's being touched upon by something that's happening in the present.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and it really works. So just flat down, just like you don't have any emotion. I remember one time Anna was crying because she was, well, I think worried about me. And when I was in my eating disorder, and I just saw her cry and just didn't feel anything. I just was like, okay, this is happening. And I'm not that kind of person, so.
Imagine if you live in your life in, you know, in denial of needs, it will just make it so hard to really connect to others, because if you can't connect to yourself, then how can you connect to other people?
Well,
I'm so happy that things have been changing for you, Janneke, and that you've come such a long way.
Yeah,
and that you and Anna are going to be wonderful PRI, young PRI therapists.
I hope so.
Oh, I think there's a very, very good chance of that. Okay, so thank you very much.
Yes.
And then I see we still have a few minutes left for a few questions. Is there anybody who would like to ask a question about anything that you saw or anything else that has to do with PRI?
The best way to ask the question is to do it by chat.
Could you explain the subtle difference between do this very well or go away and do this well, go away? Yeah, Anna, maybe you understand better than me.
Yes, I think the two different meanings you mean are do this well or go away, and the second meaning would be just go away.
Exactly.
And the difference here is that in the first meaning, where they say do this very well, they actually trigger my false hope. So they give me the opportunity to still be accepted by doing it very well. But that's not what happened. Like, the old pain is that I was sent away. So it's important to find the meaning of the exact old pain and not still engage your defense mechanism in this meaning, if that makes it any clearer.
Yeah, thanks. Very, very good explanation. This is very important, because it makes a big difference. Because if you're going to be focusing on the meaning, because what we didn't demonstrate here today, but is how do you go on then with PRI? Because what we do then next, once we have found the meaning, is then we go into the old pain, because the meaning actually is touching the old pain. So the old pain, as we saw, is coming up. Then the next step is to go into this old pain so that we really see what is in that old reality, what has been buried in our minds. And then once we see it, we can let it come up. And then as it comes up and out of our system, then we can start downloading the present day reality, the new information. And that's where the healing and transformation process of PRI comes into place. But of course, that is impossible to demonstrate in the short time that we have here. And the thing is that if you are going to focus on the meaning, which actually is not the meaning, but is the false hope of do this well or go away, if you start going into that, then you will actually be reinforcing someone's defense mechanism. You will be reinforcing their false hope. Because it will start, anything that you give attention, anything that you feel becomes stronger. So then you will reprogram yourself into thinking, I need to do this, otherwise you should go away. But the truth is, the child was just confronted with moments in which it was just like, go away, get out of here. And that's what you need to find so that you can then let it come out of your system and replace it by the truth. Very good question. Okay. Please ask any question that you might have. I mean, I remember when I had all these fears, one of the greatest fears was to ask questions, you know, in any meeting or anywhere, because I thought, oh my God, I'm going to say something so stupid. But that's just a defense. So if you have anything that you want to say or ask, please do. We still have 1 minute.
There's a last question, Ingeborg.
Okay, could it work on long-term problems too? Yes, of course, it works on any kind of problem. Long-term, short-term, small definite problem, huge problems, you know, like I once had a client that came into my office and said, well, what's your problem? My problem is I'm always unhappy. I'm unhappy all the time. And any problem becomes very, very manageable because you start to understand the mechanism that's going on in your mind. And then once you understand it, then you can see how you can work with it. So yes, PRI can be applied actually to anything, as long as you want to apply it, and as long as you have the courage, as you've seen today, to open up, because you need to open up, and you need to go against the defenses which are telling you, don't go there, like Janneke said, don't, you know. When I was asking her these questions that were approaching the old pain, it's like, oh, no. So that's good to know that your system will start to resist. But if you know this and you know there's no danger because it's over, it's, you know, there's nothing going on right now, then you can just go through, feel the old pain that's behind it, and you can really transform things in your life. Yes, Janneke, you want to add something?
Yes, I think, the most of the long-term problems are the defense mechanisms, because if you look at me, like, or if you look at eating disorders or depression, it's not that the depression is the problem, it's that just it's caused, like, it old pain is touched, and that's why you fell into a depression. So I just wanted to add that.
Very, very, very good, because that's what it is. There's one moment where something happens and we perceive unconsciously, and bam, it activates the defense. And then, for example, if you go into primary defense, you start thinking, oh, you know, I'm just never going to be good enough to finish my studies. And then you'll think, oh my God, and I'm too fat, and I'm never going to be able to lose weight. And then you think, oh, and I don't have enough friends, I'm always on my phone, and I never see anybody. How am I ever going to change my life? And then it goes from one to the next, to the next, to the next. And it can generalize into this huge feeling of being, you know, unhappy and depressed, and thinking that that's your problem, but that's not the problem. The problem is actually something that happened somewhere that triggered some defense mechanism in you, and then the defense mechanisms go haywire. And then when you go into therapy, many therapists will think that that's the problem. And so they'll start working with you and saying, no, but you're such a nice guy, you've made many friends, and of course you can get off your Facebook all the time, and of course you can do your studies. And there are other techniques, of course, to work with behavior, but the fact is that that's not the problem. The problem is before. Yeah, thank you so much, Janneke, for naming that. It's a huge, very important thing. Okay, so I see one more question. I've got 100 questions as well. And that's good to hear. But my mind seems to block after the sentence, we've got a few minutes to deal with questions. Could this be a defense? Yes, of course. Great question. Let's look at this for a moment. It's fine for me to have a few more minutes. Okay, so it means, you know, here your mind is blocking, so that could be fear reaction. Our mind blocks when we are in fear. So then the symbol, of course, would be me, because I'm saying this, and the sensory perception is this sentence, we've got a few minutes to deal with questions. So now what you can do, if you want, is close your eyes and imagine yourself becoming smaller and smaller, and then imagine me becoming really big, and I'm saying to you, okay, we have a few more minutes for questions, and just imagine what is really coming towards you. What is the meaning, what is the message behind these words that you perceive? And now this is not a rational question. It's really, you know, you go inside and you feel, you allow yourself to feel, even if it's completely irrational. And it could be something like, you know, shut up, or I want you to go away, or are you crazy? What are you doing here? It could be any, you know, of these sort of very painful messages that we get as children. Also, when our parents are doing their best and they try to love us all they can, but you know, they go into difficult situations themselves and they lose their temper, they lose, you know, their patience. So that's you know, how you could see what's the old reality that's coming towards you from that remark that I made. And yes, you're very, very observing. It's very good. Okay, so I hope this helps you a little bit. Yeah, I see the thanks. Okay, so for anybody who's interested in, you know, in knowing more about PRI, of course, I've written 5 books you could read. I mean, there are many YouTube videos. I did a TED Talk also, so there's a lot of material on the internet that you could go into. There's, of course, the website. So there's all kinds of ways that you can see if you want to, you know, get more information. There's also an online course that we're working on that you could take. So if you want to learn the tools to apply them, of course, there are therapists all over Holland. There are people that can help you. If you have specific questions, and of course, if you think about becoming a PRI therapist, please contact us through the website and take, you know, make contact with, I think, Lenneke. She's the one, she's here, and she'd be very happy to give you more information about the possibilities. Of course, you first have to finish your studies, but then what you could do afterwards. Okay, well, then I think we have come to the end of this webinar. I'm very good to see all of you, and I wish you all the best, and I hope that this has clarified some things also for you personally. So thank you so much for being here, and maybe see you next time. Okay, bye-bye. Take care, everybody.